So here with Patrick Timms, who is the deputy editor of the Wolves of Westminster blog, and we have got a lot to talk about. So we're going to talk about lifting of the restrictions. Patrick, give us your views on it, because it is, we're kind of taking a different approach to the rest of Europe, because I know that for a fact that Belgium, where I used to work in Brussels, they've only just lifted the restrictions on wearing a face mask in the street, out in the public and in outdoor spaces, which it was mandatory over there. So we're going to be, we're a bit ahead of the curve here, aren't we?
Yeah, so of course, then again, with our vaccination program, we are indeed ahead of the curve compared to you, that they will catch up. But yes, it looks like we are going to take that different sort of approach. The Prime Minister has said that there will be that lifting of restrictions from the 19th of July. You'll have nightclubs open again. The mask mandate, as the US would call it, will disappear. But of course, he is encouraging all of us to, as he says, to use common sense and wear one if you want to, and don't if you don't. The social distancing in particular is going to disappear, which of course will be great news for the entertainment industry, for pubs, for nightclubs, for all of those kind of industries that have been able to sort of operate in this kind of shadow existence, this half existence for a little while, but they still weren't able to get the revenue that they needed because they couldn't squeeze enough people in.
Yeah, exactly. So, and it is divisive, isn't it? It's a bit Marmite, this issue. It always was. It reminds me of the Brexit debate, actually. Obviously, they're completely different issues, but in terms of the divide, there is a divide. Not much in between, is there, between the two? You've got like almost half the population wanting to get rid of the mask and never enjoyed it in the first place, and I'm guessing some of them never really did it. And then you've got some people that want, some people even seem to want to wear masks forever and want it to be a permanent feature of society.
Well, what I would say there is we actually have to avoid the kind of polarization.
Because
I think really what you, I hear what you're saying there, but what you have is effectively the two most vocal ends of the debate. You've got the people who are very vocal about saying, I don't want to wear one, I'll do the distancing, I've never worn one, I'm not going to, and they're very loud and vocal. Then you've got the other people who are saying, I'm going to do it forever. It's going to be a bit like in sort of South Asian and East Asian countries where that's just the norm. But actually, I think you mustn't allow the two extremes to drown out the majority of people in the middle who are just somewhere in the middle and will hopefully do as the Prime Minister has asked all of us to do, and will just sort of use their own discretion, because that's really the point of this. So, yes, you do have some extreme angles on both ends. You've also got most people who will just act however they normally would. I look at my neighborhood out there at the moment, you know, really, you do see a range of views. Most people, I think, are not very keen on it, but, you know, hey, I think we mustn't forget that actually most people do not take an extreme view either way.
Yeah, and I think there's a good example here. We were just talking off air about, you know, the bus trips that I take, and some of them, after I'm visiting my mum, it might be, you know, a late night bus, it might be 10 o'clock and there'll be no one on the bus, and I'll go upstairs and, you know, I'm often thinking there in my face mask, well, why have I got this on? There's no need for me to put this on, and I'd rather not have it on. And I'd actually rather sometimes breathe in the fresh air as well, particularly because the windows are always open. It's pretty cold up there anyway. I'd rather just breathe in some of that fresh air. If it's going to be ventilating the bus, I'd rather breathe a little bit of it in.
Well, yes, exactly. I think there'll be lots of people who make that choice. I think I would make the same choice. But there might. I think the thing is, some of this is a psychological element. You know, there is a large swath of the population that was really quite terrified by all of this. And what the government is doing is allowing, I think, is allowing people to make their own choice, so that some people who are not quite ready yet to relax what they've got used to over the past 16 months or so, because it was part of what helped them feel safe, but not only feel safe, because of course we know that really the mask is about protecting other people. It was what made people feel that they were in control, you know, that there was something they could do to help with this, to stop the spread of the pandemic. And that's a very important psychological factor. And I think just to rip it away would have caused, well, of course, you were never going to end up in a situation where masks were banned. But, you know, I think what the government's trying to do is to be as gentle as it can with some people. Because, of course, you have the people who run pubs and that sort of thing who've been awaiting this day, this 19th of July, with bated breath. You also have people who've been dreading it.
Yeah, that's true. And Patrick, do you think that the messaging, obviously a lot of people have died here, we've got one of the highest death rates in the world, so we've got what, getting on for upwards of past 128,000 people with a COVID registered death, but do you think the messaging was perhaps too strong and not nuanced enough with the government, or can't you blame them given it's a global health crisis, because the messaging was very strong on staying at home, wasn't it? And so, you know, you can't blame people, can you, really, for doing, you know, what they think is right given the messaging that the government delivered.
It was very new. It was completely novel. Yeah. It's not something we've done before. I mean, you think back to the Spanish flu 100 years ago. You did. So you can find photos from 100 years ago of people wearing masks and that sort of thing. But the way in which we did it this time, with the distancing and everything else, plus the whole interconnected nature with everyone being in touch with each other, yes, this was very new and very novel. And at first we thought it was going to be for a few weeks, and obviously it's turned into a lot more than that. The government, I think, has been, you know, it's emerged since then in newspapers and, you know, from sources that really the messaging was actually a lot more effective than the government thought it was going to be, or even hoped it was going to be. And of course, you have the fact that really we've all, you know, all countries have been feeling their way through this. People really didn't know what was the next thing that was going to happen. When was going to be a new variant? Was there ever going to be a vaccine? You look at the vaccines. It was very much towards the end of last year that we had the first vaccines approved in this country. It was Pfizer.
Yeah.
But only a few weeks before that, the Prime Minister was telling the 1922 committee that, you know, a safe and effective vaccine may never come. So we really didn't know about this. And in terms of you know, do we have a go at the government for that? Well, if you want to have a go at the government in this country for the way that it's handled things, then you basically have to have a go at all governments all around the world, because although, as you said earlier, there are some different approaches in different countries, broadly speaking, the lockdowns, the distancing, the masks, you know, all governments pretty much have done this, and some have been far more brutal than ours.
Yeah, and I think you're right there. I mean, do you think we're approaching it differently, though? I mean, you know, because I know a lot of people are trying to almost make it part of society, wearing masks on public transport. And I know they do that, having gone to Japan for a significant amount of time. You know, I've seen how they wear masks. But, you know, I mean, it is a personal choice over there. It's not, you know, it's what they choose to do. And some people don't, in fact. So it's about choice, isn't it? And do you see, I mean, I personally see people wearing masks in years to come, and maybe a small minority of people, but certainly after 19th of July, I certainly see it'll be interesting to see what actually does happen.
Yeah, it might be something that drops off slowly over time as people begin to feel better and safer. It might be, I mean, I'm sure there are some people who will just continue to do it forever because that's in their head now. I think that's a bit of a shame because, you know, our culture is not the same as some of those Asian countries. Mm. It's not something I personally want to see imported over here because I don't think there's any real justification for it. But that's a personal feeling, and other people feel different.
Yeah.
You know, I think you'll continue to see them on the street scene, but I do also think there'll be plenty of other people who'll be quite happy to put the things in the bin and just get back on with life as it was this time 2 years ago.
Yeah, and you know, just let's finish up on this. I mean, I was a bit surprised because with Boris, because maybe if we'd had Matt Hancock in charge of the health department, we might not be having this full it's virtually a full lifting of the restrictions. I know track and trace is still going to be existing. There's going to be some restrictions at the airport, but apart from that, it's a lifting, isn't it? And I know that local businesses can also introduce their own, you know, track and trace systems, or they can ask to see, you know, various documents, etc., if you've been jabbed, etc. That's going to be at their discretion.
Yes, indeed. And of course, this is always an interesting argument, you know, when you look at how much people have been saying, oh, it's sage, it's in control, it's the scientists that are in control. If that theory holds true, then, you know, what's the minister for? And, you know, who knows? It could be that this is the direction we're always going to go in anyway, but it does look as though Sajid Javid is more keen on unlocking than his predecessor may have been. How much of a difference that makes in the running of that department, but then also the way that feeds into number 10 and the way that it makes decisions, well, we don't know, do we? But no. I suppose we'll have to wait and see.
No. What do you make of Labour's position then? Before
at the end of the day, they're not going to agree. They're going to have to find some reason to disagree with the government. Labour has come out and said, oh, no, we don't think it should be relaxed quite as much by that date, because they've got to say something, personally. Yeah. And at the end, you know, to be fair, I've looked at some of the arguments there. They're making, you know, the typical arguments that you would expect from people who are saying, look, you know, just because the schools are out or will be just about out by then, that doesn't mean the risk is gone. Typically, you're also hearing that, you know, in terms of the vaccines, there are people in hospital who have been vaccinated. My response to that is that there's not many of them, though.
Yeah.
And I don't think we're looking at the NHS being overwhelmed. But those are the kinds of concerns that...
Yeah. Brilliant. All right, I'm going to leave it there for the first half. Join us for the second half, where we'll be speaking about the by-election in Batley and Spen, and also talking a bit about Matt Hancock as well. Join us in. Back here with Patrick Timms, Deputy Editor of the Wolves of Westminster blog, and we're going to talk a bit about by-election back in Spen. 3-2-1 was the majority there, so it was a bit tight, wasn't it? But he got over the line, didn't he? Sir Keir Starmer, I think he's going to be... no one's going to be removing him anytime soon, are they now? I don't think.
Well, that's the thing. I mean, you know, for one thing, it shows you the inaccuracy of the polling, because the polling was suggesting it was going to be a Tory victory by about 6%. But actually, you know, when I look at this, I'll tell you my main thought, which is that the relationship between Starmer and Deputy Leader Rayner, Angela Rayner, has been strained for a little while, given that he moved her off campaigns after the Hartlepool defeat. He will also have been well aware, and anyone in political circles was well aware, that she and someone else were plotting to attempt to oust him if he lost this by-election. Now, the fact that he hasn't, but they've only hung on by a very small amount at a time when they should have been romping home, well, he's now, you know, what's their working relationship going to be like now? Because he now has to deal with the fact that she was planning to oust him if he didn't win. And now he hasn't, so it's as though, really, you know, it's not the best situation there.
Awkward. But, I mean, it was quite divisive, that election. We didn't hear most of it, because it was, you know, as usual, the news was, you know, saturated by COVID and restrictions lifting and whatnot. So the campaign wasn't as well covered as the Hartlepool by-election, I didn't think, at least in the mainstream media. What would you say?
Well, no, indeed. Yeah, I would agree with that. I have heard separately that there was a big problem for the Conservatives with their data on the ground, and that, in fact, perhaps they were actually sort of knocking on doors of Labour voters because their data was very out of date, and they might quite possibly have reminded several hundred Labour people to go and vote. So I what I'm hearing is that there were significant difficulties with the ground campaign. But at the same time, of course, you've also got all the other factors of the fact that you have, of course, Kim Leadbeater, to, you know, Joe Cox's sister. Now, of course, that tactic doesn't always work. In my own constituency of Crewe and Nantwich, that certainly didn't work over a decade ago when they tried running Tamsin Dunwoody, who was the sister of Gwyneth Dunwoody, the daughter, I should say, of Gwyneth Dunwoody, who had passed away. That didn't work. But I think it was an emotional campaign. It was a powerful campaign for some people. There's also been claims that, you know, Labour was attempting to appeal to the Muslim vote in particular, and that may have worked, whereas the Tories were anticipating that it wouldn't have worked. So, you know, but there's always so many factors here, and at the end of the day, you can end up making one analysis after another. As ever with democracy, you never really quite know.
Yeah, so that's interesting, and I guess, you know, for the left wing of the Labour Party, they're going to have to hold their fire a bit here, aren't they? In terms of you know, their you know, verbal attacks, aren't they? And you know, their kind of their posture, because you know, he's immovable at the moment, isn't he? And you know, who do you think would take over from Sir Keir Starmer if there were to be a challenge? Do you think it would still be? You know, do you still think it would be the deputy leader?
Well, just just before I answer that, yes, I can certainly tell you that from what I'm hearing within the left-wing circles, they were very much almost hoping that Starmer would lose by-election, because they've been hoping for some time that there will be a leadership challenge so they can stand a left-wing candidate.
Yeah.
Now, in terms of answering that question, I think certainly if we were to get to a point where a leadership contest was mooted and was definitely coming, I do imagine Rayner would stand.
Yeah.
In terms of who else would stand, I think you would get a couple of candidates from the left-wing side of things, although I'm not going to speculate on exactly who. I also think you'd get some candidates from the what you might call the Blue Labour, the Blairite end of things. So it'd be certainly a very interesting leadership contest. But do I think Rayner would try? I think she probably would.
Yeah, maybe. So that's difficult. I mean, he can't really win, can he, in a way, Sir Keir Starmer? He's in a tricky position because the Tories sewed up the Brexit vote pretty nicely last time round, which is why, you know, they've lost an MP, but they're not that bothered, are they, really? I mean, they've still got a hefty majority, so they've lost one MP, but, you know, they might gain another in the next by-election. I know they got one from gained one from Hartlepool, so they lost two by-elections, 1-1. So it's a tall order for Sir Keir Starmer, because to me he's got to please so many different groups of people, which he can't possibly do. He's got to be all things to all people.
Well, do you know, I think that's part of the issue. I think that's what he's trying to, and my personal view is that is possibly why it's not working. You know, to some degree, it's almost a bit of a Theresa May situation here, where that's what she was trying to do on the Brexit debate as well, and you know, funnily enough, that didn't work either. At some point, he's going to have to pick his direction and go in it, and accept the fact that there are some people who are not going to come along with him on that journey. But he's going to have to infuse and inspire enough of the people who are sympathetic to the direction he does want to go down, if he ever wants to take the Labour Party forward.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Moving on to Matt Hancock then. Obviously, the story's a bit old now, but I mean, do you think he's going to face a by-election? Because in his Suffolk seat, because there could be a recall petition there, couldn't there?
There could. I think if there were going to be one, we might have been hearing rumours of it by now, and I personally haven't. But I think, as with quite a lot of these things, there are plenty of times when cabinet ministers have resigned or have been... to make it a passive verb, have been resigned and have moved back to the backbenches and stayed there. And, you know, really, it depends, I think, a lot on how they behave from the backbenches and what their conduct is like. I think, you know, you have for Mr. Hancock also, unfortunately, there's a personal life issue now for him in terms of his family and the impact upon that, which I won't comment on because it's none of my business, but I would expect that to be occupying more of his thoughts. And really, it's going to be a case of, as I say, how he behaves on the back benches as to whether or not there's a recall petition. But you've got to remember, recall petitions, A, are quite new, and B, aren't actually used all that often. I don't see an impending threat from that at the moment, especially because the electorate, now that it's been told it's getting its Freedom Day within a few weeks, it's far less likely to be baying for blood, I think.
Yeah, I think you're right. You know, let's go back to the question. Would the Freedom Day have happened on the 19th of July with Matt Hancock as Secretary of State? Sajid Javid seems to be a lot more more willing to loosen up the restrictions. He sounds, I mean, I wouldn't say a lockdown sceptic, but he's much more sceptical about some of the science, if there is any science, for example, around the face masks, you know, and the kind of the gatherings, the number of people in houses, for example. I mean, he seems to be a bit more sceptical about that, I would say.
Well, I mean, you know, I wouldn't like to speculate on Mr. Javid's view of the science, but I think that the prime factor when I think about it is the fact that he is a former chancellor.
Yeah. Yeah,
I think it likely that his view is going to be swayed by the economic angle of things, as well as the health brief that he now has. At the end of the day, we're never going to know whether the change of health secretary mattered much in terms of the government's roadmap, which it had set out and had already previously sort of said we'll delay this by a month. Well, that was already there, you know. In terms of the attitude of the individual ministers towards that, maybe it's made a difference, maybe it hasn't.
Yeah.
But I think it's more likely to be, rather than the whole nature of the Freedom Day that's coming up, I think it's more likely to be the attitude to the way we handle the pandemic after that happens. Well, that will have a lot to do with the personality of whoever is the health secretary at the time.
Yeah, exactly. And he's got a big in tray now. He's saying that Sajid Javid was on the LBC earlier today, and he was saying that there's, 7 million people didn't make a GP appointment during the three lockdowns. And there's a massive waiting list, quite a few million people waiting for operations as well. I mean, the backlog is massive, because the whole, Sajid Javid said himself, the NHS isn't the COVID service, it's the National Health Service, which covers all of the healthcare issues, and that he can't just focus on one area for much longer.
Well, yes, and that does sound like an attitude that we're going to need going forwards. It isn't just there to deal with COVID, and we do need to bear in mind that there is going to be this huge backlog that's coming along, and we aren't going, importantly, in political terms, in electoral terms, well, we aren't going to be seeing the impact of that yet, but we will see it in the coming years. And of course, there'll be an election in a few years' time. So how well the service copes, and how well both the National Health Service itself and its, clientele, us, come to understand that and deal with that, well, it could be that is something that determines political fortunes, shall we say, in the future. But then you've also got to think, well, I think, it's a very easily understandable situation. Why is there a huge waiting list? Everyone knows why. It's not a case of mismanagement necessarily here. It's a case of that was what was always going to happen once this kind of situation had come to be in place.
Exactly.
So I suppose it depends on how understanding the electorate is of that.
Yeah, exactly. We're going to have to leave it there. So more next week with Patrick Timms. Join us again soon. Thanks a lot, Patrick.